Monica to our coffee and conversation today.
Let me get started. All right. My name is Connor Moore. I served 12 years in the service. Last year I served as a staff sergeant in the Army Reserves out of Brainerd, Minnesota. I was with the 309th Engineers. We were deployed to Afghanistan 2010 to 2011.
There it is.
Alright, from beginning. Like I said before, there is a video clip in here, and you're gonna hear a little swearing here and there. I apologize again. But it really portrays, gives you an idea of what our mission was. Let me give you a little demographic. Oh, sorry. I'm not going to go into extreme detail over the equipment that we used, tactics or anything like that. It is an OPSEC, operational security. It is tactics and everything that they are currently still using in a theater, so I can't indulge in information. I don't know who you're going to talk to or who they are going to talk to. So to protect our guys currently overseas, I'm going to keep that on the down low. Afghanistan. Afghanistan is located just south of Russia. It's off the Hindu Kush Mountains. Nightmare. There's nothing out there. Nothing in that country. I was stationed just a little west of Kandahar. A little small base called Camp Bastion. A British post. We expanded off onto it, called Camp Leatherneck. Housed roughly good 30,000 between civilian, different nationalities. We work with German, Danish, British, you name it.
Why is it called Leatherneck?
Based off the Marine Corps. Sorry. Marine Corps took over the theater. Helmand Province is our area of operations. Really the, go back one slide. Helmand Province is this barren wasteland. There's nothing out there. You can actually see the curvature of the earth. It is that flat. I mean, yes, there are a few dried up riverbeds where you drop down 3-4 feet, pop right back up, but there's nothing out there. One other thing. Very informal. If you guys have a question, if I throw an acronym out at you, please stop me. Ask me. If I'm going too fast, slow me down. Apologize for all that. Goresh is the major city just outside of Camp Bastion. It was equivalent to the size of St. Cloud, but the population of Minneapolis and St. Cloud combined. Just massive population, very, very poor, people living on top of people. In a house this big, you could house probably about 3 families in it. And the families consisted of 6 to 8 children, plus the parents. And if your son got married, daughters left the house, got married and left the house, son got married, that family would join you. So, very massive families, very tight spaces. Sangin was the farthest north we had pushed into Taliban country while I was in theater in Helmand Province. Now, yes, we're all over the whole country, but just in Helmand Province, the Taliban fight was so strong in Sangin, it took us 6 months just to capture the city. When I was in theater, we lost, I think it was 90 plus between Army and Marines getting that city. Here's a little closer view of Helmand Province. You can see it outlined. Like I said, Camp Bastion. This is only 30 miles apart. So, I mean, it's very scale-wise about the size of Texas. So you're not going far, but kind of get the idea. What other demographics should I give? Okay, covered it. Here's a little video.
Thank you.
See the mountains in the background? That's the Hindu Kush that was just this very northern end of Alvin Province. We never reached it. This is our Halloween 2010. You guys brought trick or treating. This is our mission. Storms are. They just come out of nowhere and you can't see anything. All right, our mission was to conduct route clearance and escort logistic supplies to remote destinations through detecting removal and controlled detonation of improvised explosive devices, which are homemade bombs, and utilizing assets provided by the counter IED defeat team, all while maintaining good standings with the local population. To go into a little further detail, find them, identify them, our explosive ordnance detail, or disposal, or EOD, their job was to collect evidence off of them and then detonate the main charge so they could not be used again. We were escorting, like I said, logistics supplies. We were bringing food, water, and fuel to these extremely remote held outposts that were, in essence, overwatching the Taliban. We knew where they were. They knew where we were. We had to run supplies. They knew what routes we took and what supplies, or what routes, I mean, for example, a Marine outpost. They knew how we got in and out of our fobs, and they just mined them. My job was to find them and identify them. The 309th Engineers was accredited with 293 finds in country. No unit had ever reached that. We were actually awarded with a presidential commendation for that. 70 by initiation, the rest were by finds, by visual or detection. All right, I'm gonna go a little brief over the type of equipment we use. The Husky, primary search vehicle. Its purpose is to get to the hostile areas where we believe, or over the years of intelligence gathering, we know this area is where they put the explosives. He would go first. It's a one-man operated vehicle. It's about the size of an earth grader. He sits inside this tiny little cubicle. It's just big enough to put his elbows. And his job is to go search for it. So all the videos you saw of the front axle, it's all this getting pushed up over. It's designed to take a blast. You can see the V-shaped bottom. Oop. Buffalo as it, whoa, didn't touch you. Go back. One more, all right. The V-shaped bottom is designed to deflect the blast outward, protecting the crew. All of our vehicles are designed that way. So, the equipment works.
Are any of those ever destroyed?
Time and time again. Constantly.
Well, I'm in the video on the front, and every time an explosion went off, another vehicle, a thing in the front slid down.
That's this right here. I can't go into the description of how that works, because they're still using this. But this is your search asset.
What does a vehicle like that cost?
$2 million. What costs the most is this piece right here. The vehicle itself is probably $800,000-$900,000. But it's designed, you see these four points, it's on the same on the other side.
Did anyone ever get killed in there?
No, we took zero fatalities. We took 70 blasts, zero fatalities.
Well, then how much is a human life worth?
Exactly. And the equipment worked, it did its job. That one where you saw this vehicle getting hit and it flipped up over the side, Blyphus, it was 80 pounds of explosives, went off underneath this tire.
Where did they make those?
These are designed out of South Africa, but made in, I don't remember where they're made, but it's a U.S. company that buys them and puts everything into them. Our Buffalo, this is our interrogation asset. Once a Husky identifies them and marks them, Buffalo will come in and takes this claw right up here, and it'll just scratch the ever-living love out of the ground until it finds it.
And when it finds it, is it detonated?
No.
Oh.
What it's trying to do is, the ground is so hard-packed over there underneath the moon dust that taking the thumb, which is the back side of the claw, so one side's got four fingers, the thumb in the back. So we'll just take the thumb, we'll scratch the ground out of it. It'll grab it and it'll pull it right out of the ground. It's kind of amazing. We have a picture of it later. Reason being, it's on the arm, keeps the vehicle at standoff. Replacing an arm, $150,000. That's it. The whole vehicle itself, probably about $3 million. But I've never seen a Buffalo completely destroyed. Because it's got a higher ground clearance, if I were to stand next to this vehicle, this rail right here, it hit me right here. It's got a huge standoff. So if we ever get hit by an IED, you got a flat tire. You're missing, part of an axle. Minor repairs. It would take the guy, the civilian contractors, a couple days to fix. We have a Buffalo back. So the equipment really was awesome.
So Connor, how many miles did you kind of have to keep open for these logistic routes? That you were monitoring with the...
Between FOB Edinburgh was our furthest most outpost that we worked with. It was probably 40 miles. Okay. And it would take us 5 days to clear that route.
So this was like a daily thing? Would they come in during the night and put new IDs?
It would take them... I have a video. It would take them less than 5 minutes to put in an ID.
Wow.
So if they know we're coming, you could just leisurely walk out of your house.
Oh.
Dig a hole in the ground.
Isn't this out in the open? I mean, where...
Yeah. You got those riverbeds I was talking about. They know, okay, well, this riverbed's got a high 4-foot wall. No truck's going to make that. Well, it kind of tapers off over here, so they're going to come over here. Hmm. Dig a little hole, and it's just the size of a 5-gallon pail. Drop it in. Put the initiation device, like a pressure plate or... Because it's all victim operated, so we have to touch it for it to go off. And it's just walk in, dig a hole, drop it in, bury it, walk away. So you never know who did it.
Could be kids.
Exactly. Honestly, it was the local farmers. And we know it's not there. They're not, Taliban. They're being paid, bribed, ransomed to do it. So it's kind of hard to identify your target. The RG-31, this is my baby. This is your security element. We had several leads protecting our convoys. It's a multi-purpose, this is what replaced the Humvees. Has the same kind of standoff. My head will get hit by the door. A little bit lower than the Buffalo, but Same V-shaped bottom, protect you. The whole thing's one solid piece. The crew cab, one solid piece, so you can't, nothing can get in. Multi-function gunnery hatch, you can attach any kind of weapon system on it. If you look at old videos of like Desert Storm when we first went in, they were just wide open. It was a post, weapon system, gunner. If you look here, we're protected all the way around. And even now they're starting to put covers on top because if you go underneath the bridge, they just drop something down on you. So, you're getting really good. This is our command vehicle. It's a 35-foot mast with a camera on it. It had infrared, night vision, thermal, you name it, it had on it. You can see up to 3-4 miles with it. So at night, we'd stop for pee break, water break, get something to eat, just take a mind off of work. He'd hoist up, start scanning 360 in case someone came up. Up front here, we have roller mounts. We'd push a roller system that would actually apply pressure to the ground in front of us, so it would blow up the rollers instead of the truck. They're cheaper to replace the rollers than it is the crew and the cab and the whole vehicle. Those things were phenomenal. When we first got in there, they didn't do their job. Halfway through tour, they upgraded the system to Sparks tubes. If you want to Google that. They're a phenomenal system. They're working amazing. Max Pro. This is a little bit bigger than the previous vehicle. We use it for our casualty evacuation. Also did the same thing. We put our bomb dog in it. He would go out and sniff the ground. If the Husky's not kind of getting an awkward hit, he didn't feel comfortable with the area, he called back and asked for dismounts. Dismounts will get out, pull security. We'd run out the bomb dog and see if he can't pick up anything. Really, it's just the same multi-function tool as the previous vehicle. It does everything, well-rounded.
It's huge.
They are very huge. You can stand up inside the back of it. And again, it's poured, it's one solid piece.
How did all this equipment get to Afghanistan?
The United States Army.
Flying it in? I mean, how would they get it in there?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, they would fly it in. C-5 is the largest aircraft that the Air Force has. It can carry 4 Abrams tanks.
Oh my goodness.
The Army has the largest vessel fleet, outdoes the Navy by a long shot. Granted, they're all contracts, but they're owned by the Army. We ship everything overseas. And then from there, it would go to Kuwait somewhere, hop on a bird, get flown into one of our major hubs, and offloaded. Max Pro Wrecker, amazing vehicle, 12 miles to the gallon. Guzzled fuel like crazy. On the other side of this picture, you can't see it, but we would have a compartment just full of extra fuel. If it were that now, that's 12 miles per gallon, unloaded, carrying just its bare minimum of equipment. You put something onto it, like if you're dragging a trailer or that crane, hoisting anything, it just guzzled fuel even more. But it was an amazing, amazing asset. It picked that Max Pro Wrecker up, or the previous vehicle, up off the ground, without hesitation. That crane is just amazingly strong. Oh, I didn't like this vehicle.
Which one?
The 960. Sorry, this is our D7 Dozer. I'll tell a little story about that in just a second. It was really good. Just your regular semi-flatbed. It's designed to carry anything smaller than our main tank, main battle tank. So it was low capacity. It was our recovery, so if a vehicle got damaged, we'd load it up on there, and we were completely self-sustainable. We had our own medics, we had our own ordnance team, we had our search assets, food, water. We were completely self-sustainable. So we also had to have our own recovery. You couldn't leave a $2 million vehicle out in the desert. And they would not allow you to blow it up. Because some cases, we had a trailer that got damaged. It was just a trailer. Nothing on it, no important information. It was just so damaged, it couldn't have been towed. They had nowhere to put it. They wanted to put an airstrike on it so they couldn't take anything from it. Nope, go back and get it. Couldn't leave anything. D7 Dozer. That's, I don't even know how heavy that thing is, but I know it drove over IEDs and it just, it's like a hiccup. It's so heavy, the IEDs couldn't do anything to it. The crew cab is the same thing as a Husky, it's completely encased. So that guy's really safe. Ours has more fines than any other asset that we have. We got one mission where it was just strike after strike and we were losing vehicles. We're in a high threat area. Taliban are watching us and getting angry, taking pop shots at us. So we knew something was gonna bad coming up. We got him offloaded and he just put it in drive and went, cleared a path. He found 14 more IEDs in just that one day. And he just plowed, just boop, oh, there's one. EOD, Explosive Ordnance Disposal. These are our Navy asset. These guys know everything about munitions, every type of. These are our evidence collectors. These are our babies. We have to protect these guys. They worked out of a Cougar, which is a heavier duty, our security vehicle that we have. You can see here the slant of the V-hull bottom, and everything else is just bolted on the outside.
So how many people would be inside of there?
It varied on the team. Okay. 3 to 5 man teams. It really depended on what unit EOD, what the recommendation was or requirement was. This is Bob Edinburg. It's about 15 miles just past this little hill crest. But you can see, nothing. That doesn't even constitute a mountain, that's just a hill. There's our dismount sweeps. You can see Topper, our marine dog handler. That's myself and my roommate. Our Huskies couldn't make this turn. I don't know, there was something wrong with our Huskies. They were having hydraulic pump failure or something like that. They couldn't turn. So our alternate was get out on the ground and start poking the dirt with your toes.
What's in the background? It almost looks like a lake. That
oh, that's
part?
The mirage from the heat. Average heat on a June day, 140 degrees, and you're wearing 80 pounds of armor, excluding your weapon, ammunition, water.
That's but it's just a dry heat.
Oh, it's very dry heat. You'd be that's sweating so crazy when you're inside a vehicle, you step out, you're like, whoo, step into a dryer.
Connor, are you carrying a sweeper?
Yes, I am. Okay. When I grew up, I used to play those little green army men toys. I always used to laugh at that little guy at the minesweeper. I'm like, what idiot would do this job? That was just a little metal detector. Thank God those things worked. They did a great job.
And Topper was one of your better bomb dogs, right?
Yes. We retired 6 dogs.
Did
when
you
I say retired,
any?
Being in the vehicle and getting blown up, they would get so shell-shocked and so any loud noise, they'd be disturbed that they wouldn't do their job. Mm-hmm. But Topper held on. He's actually accredited with a find and a half. He led us towards an area of another one. He didn't mark the actual IED, but he got us close to it.
So Connor, the IEDs, what type of weight is, you know, you said like a pressure plate, like
yes.
How much walking over it would that set them
off?
You
know, when we first got in theater, most pressure plates were made up of, I want to say it's like a pop can material, just very thin steel, not aluminum, but steel. And what they would do is take like their foam sandals and cut tiny little holes in them. And they would drop ball bearings into them. And they glue that foam, ball bearings, and then put the other one on top of it. So if you were to step on it and those pieces of metal touched the ball bearing, that would complete your circuit, setting off your main charge. Took very little pressure. But they wanted to start targeting vehicles, so it would be a 2x4. With just a little push button that you could pick up at Radio Shack with another 2x4, I had an EOD technician and myself jumping on it, and we couldn't set it off. But we set up a buzzer one at back at the camp.
Yeah.
And we could not get it to go off. It had to be a heavy, heavy item. Hmm. But that's not to say there was a few here and there. There's a one they call a crush bottle. They take a 20-ounce bottle of water, and it would spiral wire inside of it. And all it has to do is just wire touch wire. So, I mean, how much does it take to crush a water bottle? Hmm. Those are your anti-personnel, so. And the wire they would use is your alternator wire. And it's got a very thin coat of like an oil-based substance that your mine detector can't pick up. So you had to find the power source, the battery, which made it very, very difficult. Because I could put the pressure plate here, explosive right in front of you, battery way over there. You'd never know it. Here's that picture of that still frame I took from the video of Blythe is getting hit. IED strikes were a frequent. Very beginning of the tour, it was kind of a, oh dear God, he's hurt. We got to get, you know, get a medevac out there, get him help. But then after about 3 months, you're realizing equipment work. We're not, you know, government's not buying us crap like they did in Iraq. I mean, it was surprising. Humvees would just turn inside out, but these things, like this one, gets flipped up and moved over 50 feet. He walks away with a couple bumps and bruises.
Does the machine still work? Does it still function?
No. There was 80 pounds of explosives, so it just literally tore off the whole front end. That, those panels in front, they're made out of styrofoam. And it's just all computer components inside of it, so those things, you sneeze on them with enough pressure, they'll crack and then they don't work right. But we have spare parts, so we'll drive up to our next outpost, repair it, it's good to go. Because the motor and everything's housed inside that really long part, so the motor is always fine. Excuse me. Had the soda for lunch, so it's coming back on me. This is our old style wrecker. They got rid of it purely because you can see how many wheels are on the ground, and the crew cab is not safe at all. It's steel about that thick. It could not take a hit. In fact, we only have one mission, it took a hit. My favorite gunner was very mechanically inclined, and our real mechanic had gotten injured earlier, so we asked him to go help out the wrecker crew. I thought he was done for. It turned his seat up into the windshield. I don't know how he survived. But recoveries were actually pretty quick. Most strikes that we did take were on the rollers. Like here's beginning of the tour, they had the crappy ones. It was just a quick, we'd have extra roller mounts in the back, hoist the trailer up, hook them on, be right back on a mission. It'd be self-sustainable. You can see, all the way back. We would escort, I want to say probably at the smallest 80 vehicles to the largest, I think we did 250 behind us, escorting through the desert. Funny story, we would mark our route with, we call them chem lights, you guys call them glow sticks, the little short ones. We'd throw chem lights to mark our path. The Taliban are so smart, yet so dumb. How they can make their country so productive with such little is amazing. But at the same time, they believe those little chem lights would protect them from the Taliban. So anytime they would stop, they would steal them, and they'd stick them inside their truck. We caught one guy, he had 40 of them crammed in the grill, and then like 20 more up on his dashboard. And another guy we caught, and he would throw them way out in the desert. Now that's not where we cleared, but what they believed, there was a force field. It would keep the Taliban away. So if I put them in my grill, it'll protect my vehicle. And if I throw them way over there, keep the Taliban way away from me, so I'm safe. Like, how are you guys a functioning colony or a society? Never could figure it out. Another responsibility we had, medevac landing zones, or medical evacuation. These were really tough to do, purely because you saw how the sand is. This bird is not even 50 feet from the ground. Look how much he's kicking up. To thoroughly clear it, we had to clear it 3 times. So it was dismount, and then we would send, actually it was husky, dismount, and then we would have to roll it. Take the rollers on the front truck. That's a lot of foot traffic going over one area, kicking up more dust. We had a Black Hawk come down, and he missed the landing zone because he couldn't see it. Hit the ground, bounced, and bounced back down into a wadi, kicked the suspension up into the cab. That guy got in deep trouble.
And a wadi is what again?
Dried up riverbed.
Okay.
Sorry. Good fun. This was 100 pounds of explosives. Surprisingly, it didn't do much to the vehicle at all. Crew was evacuated because there was kind of awkward circumstances. So we, just to be on the safe side, we got rid of them all. We got a whole new crew in. I think that's everything I'm going to talk about formally. So I'm going to kind of like open up for questions or anything else.
You should show the video of your Purple Heart.
My Purple Heart video?
Yeah.
I can do that. Down. This is Fob Signs had just put in an outpost probably about 2 miles south of us. And we had just left Fob Signs. We just head north to, I don't remember the name of the fob. It was a really small, brand new outpost. It was protected by a platoon of Marines. It's all down there. Very small. And we would call them black routes if no one had been on the route more than, like, 3 to 6 hours. There's a route clearance has to go through. After 5 minutes we go through, it's no longer clear. Anything longer than that, it starts getting color-coded between its security level. We're just on the cusp of what we called known area of interest, Taliban area. We're kind of trying to pass through, cut the corner, I guess you can call it. We have a deep, Helmand River is to our east by a mile, if that, but it's just a sheer cliff. So we can't go farther east. We go west, we're in a very, very dense Taliban area. So it's kind of between a rock and a hard place. We've got to squeeze by. And in this video, I am trying to, there we go. And right off the bat, you'll see my reverse light kick on. What I'm doing is I'm calling back to the guy who's operating this vehicle. You can see the panels right here. He's operating the Husky. Hey, get ready, fire up. I don't feel comfortable, you need to take front. So we're about to change places. Reason being is, you barely see it, but there's rocks about the size of your palm. Two of them stand up, stacked up. Nature doesn't do that. It's local nationals communicating to other local nationals. There's something dangerous in the area. And unbeknownst to myself, I already passed one. I'm on the passenger side, what they call a truck commander, or TC. And my driver was watching left side, I was watching right, and I just happened to scan over, saw it. He was watching, actually. There were some suspicious people up over there, so he didn't even see it. So I tell him to put it reverse.
What kind of vehicle are you in?
That's the RG-31. That's the replacement for the Humvee. This is the general multi-purpose. So I tell him to put it in reverse, back up. Let's get the Husky up front. There's my brake light.
Oh,
80 pounds of explosives. Took out the back left tire. Went off underneath the gunner's butt. Gunner. Nothing wrong. Strangest thing. I'm 12 feet away. He was 2 feet away. He had no damage. I have a compressed spine, 6 bulging discs, and a traumatic brain injury. I don't get it. Nobody does.
So Connor, there's a lot of video there. Are all the, do you have constant video going on, like police cars, for example, or is that why there's...
When we reach, like I was saying, a black route, the Husky operators are told to turn on their cameras and start recording. And he knew we were coming up to the area, so he flipped us the camera on 16 minutes prior. That's how we caught the video. Reason being is match whatever in data that they collect with a search element to the video, so they can compare it up with the civilians. Some of all us, they wouldn't let us know.
So is that the same vehicle?
That was the Buffalo. It's got the arm up front. No, my I have another video of it being pulled away by the D7 dozer, and you can see the damage to it.
What is likely to happen to all that equipment when the United States leaves Afghanistan?
When we left Iraq, a lot of it is sold to the Iraqi army. We take out all the sensitive items, like our radios. I shouldn't say weapon systems, because we sold a lot of our weapon systems to them. Most of it gets, I really don't want to tell you guys this, probably have a heart attack. Get rid of it, burn it, destroy it. It costs more money to ship it back home than to make new ones.
Like that picture you had early on with those natives sitting by their house or hut or whatever that was. It always looks like there's nothing to eat but sand. What do they eat?
Thank you for asking that. That's actually one thing I forgot to talk about. The prominent crop in Afghanistan is opium. Right alongside that, next, close second, but the lowest on the totem pole is wheat. We are trying to buy the opium out, stop making opium, start making wheat. So they would produce, flour for themselves, trying to get them to be self-sustainable country.
But they can make more money with opium than they can with wheat.
Exactly. One crop of opium will sustain them for 2 years. One crop of wheat, get them through half a year. That's kind of a...
So what is their diet?
Chicken, anything that you can do with flour, and they have a lot of imported rice. China's right next door. And then really strange fruit and vegetables.
Melon.
Yeah. It's watermelon. What they call it, melon.
It tastes like honeydew.
Yeah, it's really
But it has like the consistency of watermelon.
It's really delicious.
And it's amazing.
I don't think you have it here.
It's like the only thing I miss from Afghanistan is melon. Yeah, that's about it. So.
Those are our living conditions. Just pop a cot upside the vehicles between stops.
Were you and your wife there at the same time?
No. Monica was there in 2003, the initial insertion. And I was in there 2010 to 2011.
Yeah, I had a totally different type of job. I worked with the host nation, so I was always with the population. I was always with the people. I worked in hospitals and clinics, and I worked in orphanages. I'm saying that right. I worked with orphans and women in schools. We built schools. We built wells. My whole job in the army in Afghanistan was to make the host nation like us and not want to kill us. It was my sole job. So I worked with military intelligence and psychological operations, and then the special forces. We worked with a small team of special forces to take us to places we wanted to go. So when we'd have the Taliban try to kill us, it was normally on smaller scales, like within huge crowds. So like if we were trying to give away newspapers to talk about how great America was and that we were real nice and we were going to do good things, we'd have them made, the psychological operations would create it, and then when we'd be giving them out in, like, you know, there'd be crowds of people or something. Our armor was different than what Connor had. Back then we had just a big plate in the front and then a big plate in the back, and it was nothing on either side. So they would try to come up within crowds, and they would take knives and try to get it in between your ribs on the side. They could get within a few feet of people, especially to within like markets and stuff. They would try to just do sniper fire if we were trying to buy something or work with some of the host nation within like the smaller downtowns. But then they upgraded the armor, and you had better armor, actually.
Between Iraq, I was in Iraq in, when was it, 2005? They started with something small. It was like, I can't think of, Kevlar. Sorry.
Yep.
It's just a little Kevlar fabric. All it could really do was stop knives. But then there was, started coming a problem with shrapnel. Could get through it with no problem. So in Afghanistan, 2011, they upgraded the system even more. So you're completely surrounded in this thick, heavy plate. Oh, it's cumbersome. And they even had pieces that go high up on your neck. So only thing that's exposed is your ears and your mouth and your face. Everything else is covered. Anything vital.
Yeah, ours wasn't that. Involved. I mean, we had Kevlar and stuff. We worked to, like, I worked more with foreign groups. Like, we had a Korean medical team that we worked with, or like the Egyptians, or the Germans. So that made it a little different too, just because they were even less armed and even less protected than we were. So, you know, I mean, they would just run and hide a lot. You know, well, I would too, I guess, if you're just walking around in a t-shirt. I don't know, you know. Yeah, so.
How long were your firefights over there, usually?
Yeah, our firefights were longer, especially they would like to shoot. They would attack us a lot when we were getting our resupplies from our birds, because we were, when you saw the initial map that he brought up, where they showed Kabul. Kabul is like their main city, it's like their capital, yep. I was further north. I was towards the Hindu Kush in Kunduz. And what we would do there is they would fly a lot of our stuff in and do big drops. And what they would do is they'd attack the airfield and then try to shoot all of us so that we would scatter, and then our plane wouldn't drop anything. Or if our plane had already done the drop, then they could steal all our food. So then, you know, in hopes that we would starve to death, so I guess. So yeah, ours were a lot longer because they were, we were fighting while the, you know, our planes and our resupplies would come. So yours, like I said, was more like one shot here and there. Or?
It depended where you were. If you got closer to the Taliban central, it was really sustainable firefights. Unlike Iraq, they would just unload a magazine, run away. Afghanistan, 45-minute firefight was a good thing. Anything longer than that. We got one day, it took an entire day to go 400 yards between IEDs and firefights, mortars. This is a fun picture. Whenever we got back to Camp Bastion, this is our living quarters. We'd fit 12 guys in one little room, bunk them up. That's when we got back. You get 4 days of luxury, and then you're out for 14 days, 7 days. Come back.
Do you feel the Taliban is as big a threat now as like when you first went over there, or is it?
My team leader, I was a squad leader in Afghanistan, my first team leader, he just went back to Afghanistan, actually. He's due home here shortly. When we were there, we were told by intel, whoever that is, that the Taliban is broke. We've cut off their funds, we've squeezed their wallet, they have no money, they can't produce bombs, they can't fight. And they said this is going to be their last hurrah. And it was a blistering, horrible fight. And then Sergeant Gabbert, who just went back, he said there's nothing. Nothing to do.
But what happens when
we could walk down the streets and nothing would happen. Yep.
But what happens when we leave there?
If we pull out as quickly as we did in Iraq, the country will go into civil war, just like Iraq is in. That was the dumbest decision to do.
Do you feel there's any hope for those countries, Afghanistan and Iraq, to be a democracy?
They don't want it. They do not want it.
Why are we there?
They don't care. It's a very interesting dynamic how they live. It's very clan. Think back, way back. I mean, 16th century, where your family was only so big, but that's who you protected and that's who you cared for. So clans would fight clans, but with a bigger umbrella, there'd be some head, you know, an ultra clan, I guess you could call it, who would protect all of them. So they're always fighting. They're fighting each other, fighting clan by clan or tribe. That's the word I was looking for. A tribe would be a higher echelon to a clan. They're happy with that. That's what they want. They don't care about democracy. The mentality is, we've been at war for 11 years. And before that, another 10 years with Russia.
Yeah, they're always
we've been fighting each other in between. They don't want us there. We don't want to be there.
And we're there because.
What's that?
And we're there because.
I don't know.
Generals.
Yeah.
Underneath Afghanistan, I don't know if you guys know this, there's over $100 billion in titanium, lithium, from a copper mine, and all these local lords own the land. So I don't know, this is just my perspective. China's already offered to pay for it. They can mine it, but China wants it. Your countries in Europe want it, we want it. Afghanistan doesn't care. They don't know what it's for.
Comparing your time in Iraq and Afghanistan, what were the biggest differences of your experience?
As in?
Mission and then of the dynamics of the war too, I guess.
Mission-wise, combat engineers did not do route clearance. They really didn't exist, route clearance didn't. It was a whole new fight. They're not used to getting blown up on the side of the road. I was attached to an infantry unit. I was a forward observer. My job then was to support infantry movement by artillery. So my whole life was a radio. I was the lucky charm in Iraq. Nothing happened when I went on a mission. I walked out of there with no scratches, no bumps or bruises. Everybody wanted me on mission because nothing would happen. Afghanistan was a longer story. I'm trying to stay on Iraq for a quick second. Where Iraq is a lot more life, as in the land seems more fertile. You have farmers that are just everywhere. They can go for miles. They still can get water from the river miles and miles away from. I can't even think of the name of the river.
Euphrates River.
Through aqueduct systems, the infrastructure is phenomenal. They have highways. They have between Ramadi, Fallujah, apartment buildings, governments. I mean, they had a government system. Afghanistan, mud huts. If you had a door, you were considered middle class. Depending on what kind of door you had, varied on what kind of middle class you were. If you had a rug or a blanket, you were the lower middle class. If you had a wood door, you're mid-middle class. If you had a steel door, you're upper middle class. Also, what size of a mud wall you had. Most commonly, you saw nothing, but if you did see a wall, it was about knee-high. So that would be mid-class. But if you had a 12-foot-high wall, you were very wealthy. They live off of $1,000 a year. That's their annual income.
And what do they do to make that $1,000? What?
Anything. Steal equipment off our trucks and sell it. I have no idea how they did it. I wish I could show you the picture. On the front of an RG, on like the bumper, the headlight is behind a solid steel, it's got steel bars on it. It's a little, pardon the language, bastard, somehow got the light bulb out. I have no idea, without taking a single bolt out. I had to redo the wiring on it, and it took me hours to get
what
to
is
it.
This?
Oh, sorry, let me stay a little close. That is a Talon robot. That is what EOD would use to pull the explosives on the ground or pull evidence off the IEDs. That way, they're nowhere near the main charge. We try to stay away from those things as much as possible.
All right,
it's kind of a very poor picture. It looks cooler on the laptop. What was my?
I'm sorry, you. I interrupted you. You were talking about how she asked how did they make $1,000? How do they make money?
Thank you. Sorry, traumatic brain injury. Very poor memory. Another big thing, just outside Camp Leatherneck, we had a huge city pop in. We would hire local nationals to haul fuel for us, and they would get paid $150 for a route. I mean, you're only going 20, 30 miles. They get paid when they get returned. So they get the fuel, they're in our convoy. When they get there, and when they get back to a safe area, we give them a slip. Say, here, this is a voucher, good for $150. They go back to Camp Leatherneck, pick up $150. That's a huge portion. That's a huge source of income. And it only took them 3 days to get it, 4 days. Excuse me. You do that multiple times, he's making money. Some of the guys that we worked with were making 15 grand a year. They upgraded the truck. I don't know if you saw the previous one, that little guy walking in a small fuel truck. One little fun story. They would have an open flame in their cab to heat it, hauling jet fuel.
Huh. Okay.
You're kind of courageous.
Do they sell opium on a black market, or is that open market, or what do they do with it?
Just after harvest is probably my favorite time. I don't know if you guys know how they harvest opium, but it's a gorgeous little flower. Stands about this tall. On the top of it's got a little bud right underneath the flower. It's actually perfectly legal to have them in the United States. You cannot harvest them, though. To harvest them, you take a razor blade and you score the bud. Just 2-3 times. Overnight, a pus will come out. The next morning, you go out there and you scrape off that pus. And during the day, you score it some more, so it does it again. You can probably get 2 weeks out of a bud just collecting that pus. And that pure opium, they'd roll it in their cigarettes, put it in their tobacco, chewing tobacco. Those drivers were fun to watch. They had some serious courage. After they got their helping with it, the warlords in the area, they would collect it up. It would be shipped out through Pakistan.
Mostly head straight to Europe.
Yep, head mostly straight to Europe.
And then from Europe, it's you know, refined, sold, mixed with other things, and then shipped off to places like the United States, where then you're buying it on the, you know, then you have like the street grade, basically. When I was in Afghanistan in 2003, the Department of Defense was the most interested in destroying the opium trade. They thought that would be the best bet. So I worked with someone within the Department of Defense who had worked with Bush, had come and flew out and worked. He spent some time with me and a couple other people and then the Special Forces to guard us. And we went and toured all of the opium fields and met with warlords. So I had an opportunity to have, I had a dinner with the president of Afghanistan. He was actually a very nice guy. A little messed up, but... What?
He's a crook.
He's a big crook, but he's a nice guy. Dirty as he comes. But no, but you know, for dinner, it's fine, you know. I met quite a few of the and the same with the warlords. It's very hard because they call themselves generals. They tend to have small armies. They tend to have huge weapons caches that they're doing a very good job hiding and that kind of thing. So they have the money to do it. Their houses are amazing. They're beautiful mansions. Just amazing houses. So,
do you have to learn different languages over there?
Yes. Iraq was, there's a specific dialect to Arabic. I can't remember off the top of my head. But then Afghanistan's Pashto, which is kind of like the educated side of.
That's true. But
if you could afford to go to school, you learn Pashto. There was another dialect that was basically like slang. Like if you go down to Arkansas and backwoods kids that never went to school, you got that really thick dialect you can't really understand. That was really what you got, mostly. I think it's like 2% population's educated.
If they didn't have the opium to grow and harvest and they live on $1,000 a year now, what would it be replaced with? I mean, if the United States wants to destroy their cash crop, then wouldn't the United States have to replace it with something?
We were trying to buy them out with wheat.
But
see,
wheat, like you said,
a room this big in opium, he could get $500-$600 worth. But realistically, being back stateside, you guys know a room this big in opium is probably like
opium
this big.
Yeah.
You'd probably get $500,000 worth.
Or prison time.
Well, I'm just saying, they're paid nothing for the opium, the farmers are. The warlords are who are making the money, because they know opium's worth.
Hey, your Christmas tree.
Oh, yeah.
So is the U.S. still trying to destroy the opium?
Yes. We were lighting, we ran across pot fields, pot plants.
Oh,
easy,
amazing.
This tall. Just hundreds of yards long.
So if
wide.
They replace it with wheat, then the people will go from living off $1,000 a year to about $100 a year?
Well, no, what I'm saying is, so now it would take a room about this big to have a good crop. Wheat, you need about 6 times that much.
Right.
So now if you only have 3 kids to help you farm it, that's a lot of land, a lot of wheat, a lot of work, when I could use a portion of it and make just as much.
Hasn't anyone tried to help them develop their mineral industries, like titanium and whatever, to make money?
When I was over there, it was really in its infancy. I haven't followed it after that. I know it was a huge discussion. Like China, they were trying to bribe the president.
Yeah, they don't want to teach them. They just want it.
But how can they get it?
They would be happy if they were in a civil war and they could start buying.
For example, China would fund Warlord X to, hey, we'll pay for the compound, we'll have it all built, you'll take your people and work the mines, we get the product.
That would give them jobs.
It would. Mm-hmm. But you know the warlord's not going to pay him anything, pettins, and the warlord's going to walk away with thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
So who are you really helping?
The warlord.
Exactly.
And so that's where does the U.S. stand on this?
It is a very sensitive topic. Trying to get, because you get rid of one warlord, 3 will step up in its place.
Yeah, sometimes for us it was just easier to deal with, like, if one warlord wasn't so bad, comparatively speaking. I mean, I spent some time with, especially with, like, military intelligence or, like, the psychological operations. I mean, they would do their reports on, like, who's not so bad. Maybe we'll keep that guy, because he's not as bad as, as...
Perfect example to that is in Iraq, I found out that Saddam Hussein had a detail following him. U.S. soldiers, a strike team, just waiting for the command to go. They did not want to kill him because Uday and Usay are psychotic. And they didn't want them taking over. And they didn't know where those two were. So it's kind of like, who do I go with?
Yeah, it was Uday's palace that you guys took over, right? And then you guys tried to make a pool?
No, that was Camp Liberty.
Yeah.
Which is just on the very... I'm sure you guys all heard of Abu Ghraib Prison. It's right on the edge of Baghdad and south of Abu Ghraib. And...
But it was
3 beautiful Saddam's palaces. And in the lake... Uday took over one of the palaces, and we tried to make it into a swimming area. It's 140 degrees. Why not go swimming? Well, they would take a big backhoe or whatever they're called, heavy equipment, and they would scoop up, try to get sand in there and get rid of the muck. It would just be bodies after bodies.
Oh, bodies.
And they were all women.
Oh.
It was Uday's women.
Uday's what?
Women.
Yeah, he went through girls pretty hard.
He would go through teenage girls like kids do with candy.
Yeah.
He would have his way with them, get bored with them, torture them, kill them, dump their bodies in the water.
Oh. Connor has a piece of marble from that palace, right?
Actual Uday's house.
That's from Uday's house, yes.
Which is off of Lake Takatam. Or, sorry, Camp Takatam, Lake Habaniya.
Yeah.
Mistake.
So what's your best memory of Afghanistan? Got any?
Something good?
Best.
Well, something better than, you know, bodies floating in water. How about something better?
Okay,
than, you know?
I'm actually going to go back to the picture that you saw, the blue Christmas tree. It was Christmas Eve in Afghanistan. We had just gotten to our destination, and Don Brown took 80 pounds of explosives to the rollers. It flipped the rollers up and knocked out the whole crew. The captain, Don Brown was the driver, and the gunner. They all blacked out. So the morale just plummeted after that. Our captain went down. I got to FOB Signs, which is just, it's a very southern tip of the Sangin province, so it's kind of a hostile area. On a whim, I went and stole the captain's blue Christmas lights just before the mission, because I wanted to do something for the guys, kind of keep the morale up. I found a pallet, and I broke the pallet apart, and I built a Christmas tree. And I took chem lights, the blue lights, and I did whatever I could to make it look like a Christmas tree, and I slapped it to the bumper of the truck, hooked it up to the batteries, had Christmas lights. And then we started a bonfire, and I went and raided the British food container, and I made all the guys dinner. That's probably my favorite. Morale skyrocketed after that. I'm sure you guys saw the picture of us wearing the little red Santa hats. That was Christmas Day. Everybody was in such a better mood. Captain recovered. He was fine.
Did you see any part of Afghanistan other than Helmand province?
Kandahar, which is a province to our east.
Is there any green in Afghanistan?
Kandahar province, yes.
Okay.
Because there is a river. Guresh had the Helmand River going through it, but they didn't run aqueducts to push everything out. They just built on top and went vertical.
Kunduz was very frightening. The opium and the pot, the weed marijuana that would grow through the it was just green. It was amazing. So like when we got there, we were more expecting pure sand all the time. But we had, and then when we'd go up and through the mountain ranges, it was beautiful up through the mountains, because we would make treks deep in the mountains to bring presents to the children and stuff, like backpacks, school supplies, stuff like that, and that was better too. It's a mix. You learn to hate the children and love them all at the same time, because they're often when I was there, they were often used against us a lot. So I mean, one time, you know, you could be working with one an orphan, and everything was, you know, great, and they were sweet and everything like that. And then one of the things they would do is they would put explosives in a pen, and then they would come up and they'd hand you, they'd say, you dropped your pen. And then the minute you know, a lot of soldiers would put it in their pocket, and then later when they took it out and they clicked it, it would explode. So.
Oh wow.
Never knew your enemy.
No.
Never knew them.
Also because, the kids were often...
What shoes he has
on? Rocks.
They're rocks.
Rocks, yes.
Colors and then they brought over. They would also, like, the kids would run in between our vehicles and use magnets to explosives, and then, you know, let the magnets sit underneath the vehicles, so that then as soon as we started to drive away, there'd be someone who detonate it. So after a while, our guards would have to try to keep the kids from being able to run anywhere in or around the vehicles, because there was so much damage. I actually lost people overseas. Connor didn't, so he had better luck than me.
We left 270. We came home 270. We did lose our unit behind us. I contributed to the morons not wearing their equipment and doing their job correctly. Lost two guys behind us, and we lost an EOD technician to an anti-personnel mine that he didn't see. They had put up a dummy IED, and then just right in front of it, an anti-personnel. Which is actually his anniversary on March 5th.
I'm wondering if it's hard for you to see all this again.
My psychologist says I'm cold and dead inside.
That's true. That's what they tell him at the VA.
Yeah.
Connor's too
logical. I've been through three tours. They said my emotions have been severed. And I haven't transitioned back to being human, I guess you could say. Oh. I put a lot of logical, I think rationally, kind of, it's a win-lose, I guess. I like it, but other people around me calls me cold and heartless and a hermit.
Are you retired?
I am medically retired. I got home and I had 2 years left on my contract. I wanted to do the honorable thing and finish out my 2 years. I got assigned to a unit on Sioux Falls, and First Sergeant kind of gunned out for me, had it for me, just not happy with me, because I called them all pansies for being at the age of retirement and never being deployed over an 11-year war, and I didn't understand how they could do it. So I kind of was a snake in his boot, and he wasn't happy about it. And I couldn't do the basic soldiering anymore, the PT test, the physical fitness. I couldn't run, I couldn't do sit-ups. And I was trying to kind of get around it, just let me finish on my contract and I'll walk away, I'm done. But he kind of fast-forwarded the process, so I put in my medical board and they medically retired me.
How do you see the morale right now in the general services? You stay in contact, and you know, with your friends and that are still in it. You know, how is the overall morale? Would you say, from your perspective,
from the guys that deployed to the new guys that are in, there is a drastic difference. The guys that came home, they're a little more PTSD, you know, a little more angry, a little more volatile towards the Arabic nations. The younger generation are more hopeful. They're looking forward to the training. The vets are kind of, I'm done, I'm burnt out. Because the Army asks so much of you, right? All branches. Like I was saying earlier, pain is weakness leaving the body. Well, when I was at this last year I was in, you need to run. I can't, I hurt. What's pain leaving, weakness leaving the body? No, it hurts. I know what muscle fatigue is. Spinal compression, six bulging discs. That's not normal. But to them, go, you can still do the job. So you got all these vets who are just worn down, beaten, bruised, and
too many deployments.
I don't know how Marines do it. I really don't. I respect you if you do it. 6 months there, 3 months home, 6 months there, 3 months home, 6 months there. Continuous.
What can we as regular citizens do to help, you know, show our support and to help those that have some deployed?
You know, surprisingly, if you're willing to do it, care packages were a phenomenal morale boost. If you can get a care package to the furthest most outpost where those guys hardly get anything, I mean, we got Girl Scout cookies, we got, sometimes you run out of toothpaste, all some big box of toothpaste shows up, like, sweet. just little simple things like that.
Since Connor's been back too, Connor's roommate, who you saw in the video right before the bomb dog, he started working with the Wounded Warrior Project, which I guess if you guys ever buy brawny paper towels, you can sometimes see that logo of it, looks like a man carrying another soldier. He works here in, he covers Minnesota,
Iowa, North Dakota, South Dakota, North Dakota, and Nebraska.
In Nebraska, and he looks for vets from Afghanistan and Iraq, so OEIF, so Operation Enduring Freedom and Operation Iraqi Freedom, and he tries to find soldiers and or ex-soldiers, depending on where they're at in their process, and if they've been wounded at any kind, they do programs to help unite the soldiers so that they have someone to talk to. They do peer mentoring, they do care packages, they do they just help give the soldiers somebody to spend time with outside of you know, being alone. Like Connor said, like one of his friends who his driver who was blown up with him is way out alone in Texas, and he's not around any of the soldiers that he deployed with. He's not with any unit. You know, they tend to fall into a lot of a depression. They sit on the couch, they start drinking. You know, that's tend to be the the average. So there's been programs like that now that have been starting to help, maybe, you know, help the soldiers to, they say, do more like economic empowerment, so like getting jobs, and then as well as like
spiritual
and helping them feel connected to people again and that kind of thing, for those who do not do as well transitioning when they come home.
Do you have contact information for some of these different programs or
you could
packages?
Google. You'd be surprised. Units deploying, it's amazing. Even, you know, some of the tactics that we use I didn't bring up, you'll find them on Google. I found the exact location of some stuff that you're not supposed to know about on Google. I was curious. Just wondered, oh, what's on here? Oh, geez. All right. You can probably find out how the Husky operates. It's amazing. I'm going to piggyback off Monica real quick. In the military, you're really trained to take care of your fellow soldier, Marine, whatever. You're usually paired up with a buddy. Once you're out of the military, they wash their hands of you and you're done. Wounded Warrior Project picks up that mentality. We're going to take care of each other. It's vets taking care of vets. That's what it is. I mean, it's vets who've been there. They've been through the pain. They know what you're talking about. Take care of your own. That was my thought.
That's okay. Basically, what Connor's saying is that since you spend, you know, 8, 12, however many years in the service learning to rely on a battle buddy, basically it's to give you buddies again that you can rely on for, you know, whatever kind of help. And it's one of the reasons why I think with Connor and I, we've done as well as we have transitioning out of the service and transitioning through the deployments that we've done, is because in the end, military-wise, I do understand him and he really understands me. So we weren't left alone. Like a lot of men who maybe their spouses, or a lot of women who maybe their spouses don't understand, and like I said, or that they're no longer in their units. We meet a lot of soldiers now who, you know, who will say like they go back to, you know, see their guys from their units, men they've served with, and you know they're in a wheelchair and they don't want to see them. They don't, because they represent what can happen to you in the service, and they don't want to see that. They don't want to see what could really happen. So.
Another spinoff on WWP is what we, Wounded Warrior Project. We don't only take care of veterans, we also take care of their families. Because we know to help heal a veteran, it takes a family. So like if someone were to take care of me, well, Monica's in the background getting stressed out with certain things, well, the family members will come. For example, we'll do, Wounded Warrior Project's really known for Project Odyssey, which is they'll do a 5-day retreat, collect up a bunch of vets, no therapists, no counselors, we'll go kayaking, fishing, rock climbing. And what they're trying to do is get vets talking with vets, and it's its own therapy in itself. And in that time, the family's back at home, they'll take the family, okay, spouse, we'll take you for spa day, we'll take you out shopping. Get you away from, get you off his mind, you know, get him off your mind, take off the focus. Very rejuvenating. And what I'm trying to do with that is kind of plug the information in your mind. So if you know any vets at all that need help, according to the Wounded Warrior Project.
It's a good program.
It's a great program.
Yeah.
That sharpshooter in Texas, wasn't he trying to help?
Yes, he actually, he was starting up his own organization. And
he was killed by one of them.
I got my theories behind that one. Yes, that's what they report say. He was opening up a good gun range for vets to go out there, shoot rifles just to calm down. You know, I don't know if any of you guys have fired a weapon. Sometimes when you get really angry and frustrated, just shooting a gun down a range, very calming.
Again, it's 12 years in the service. It's
yes.
Hard to, it's sometimes it's harder to understand.
It is. It's a lot of civilians don't understand that.
Why do you think the morale is bad, or do you think it's just the same in every war?
Same in every war.
How come, what is your idea of the number of suicides?
Can I actually answer that?
Yeah, because there's been a lot of suicides in this
this one specifically.
War.
They said that one of the difference, because I did some research on this, they said that one of the big difference was, especially when you talk about like World War I and World War II and a lot of the other wars prior, is that soldiers, after the war ended or after their stint, they had to spend a lot of time going home. It took a lot of time, especially like World War II, where they had to sit on ships together for hours or days or months. There was so much time that they spent literally unwinding with other people who understood them, who knew exactly what they'd been through. There was a camaraderie, a connection that they had with these people that they could go through. Where they're saying now, especially with like Afghanistan and Iraq, it's you're in country 2 days later, you're not anymore. You're in an air-conditioned, beautiful, you know, place having dinner, and you're supposed to, and the expectation was that you're supposed to switch from being hardcore, killing people, survival, to dinner with your mom, like, done, and that because there's no longer that timeline, there's no longer that time that you're going to spend literally decompressing, they're saying it's causing some problems. I've spent some time at the VA in the mental health area, with some of the therapists and stuff for like PTSD, and where, like I said, and because like the suicide rate is super high, and they're like, it's hard now too, because with soldiers, the expectation is that if you hang out with, like I said, if you go back to your unit and you're hanging out with the guys, it's for a lot of them, sometimes it's better, but if they get higher rank, which like Connor was one of those who was, he was promoted while overseas, so then moved to another unit. All those guys, again, are now dropped in the middle. All their guys are gone. All the people that they serve with, all the people that they spend time with, they're all gone, and they are literally dropped in a situation where they have to go back to a wife who doesn't understand. You know, they've been gone a year. They don't know what happened to them. They're not going to share with because they don't want to scare. They have, you know, they have to, their responsibilities, they're supposed to return to maybe a job that they're not physically able to do, mixed with the fact that they're now maybe in a military unit with a bunch of guys who weren't there, they don't know, and they don't have the same camaraderie connection, which makes them feel isolated, and then you have a higher rate of suicide.
Do you think the culture has changed at all, too, since, like, say, World War II, for instance, because... I mean, similar then. I mean, the men didn't talk to their wives about it and stuff.
Yes, but at the same time, I think that, like, with the... See, with a lot of the other soldiers, we do have a benefit now, which is that... like, I saw a bumper sticker the other day that said, vets will never forget vets again, because that's what happened with, like...
Vietnam, Korea.
The difference, I will say now, that we have as a benefit is we have even people who hate the war will support the soldier, which is a big difference, whereas a lot of the other war vets never had that. They didn't have the support of their community. They didn't have the support of groups. I mean, hence the birth of, like, VFWs and American Legions, but still, it's better. That part of it is better now, is that you have just regular support from people who walk up to you and say, like, thank you for your service. I mean, they're not, you know, spitting on you in an airport, you know, or calling you a baby killer kind of thing. So.
But during World War II, we had the civilians helping with the war effort. This time it's been all different.
Yes, that's true, too.
Yes.
You know.
It surprised me. I never understood why they wouldn't... Having the backing of a government armed forces that didn't trust. They were more afraid of the Taliban, who was 2 hours away, and we're right outside their door. Point to us. Where are they? Who are they? Who's the bomb maker? Tell us. We'll go kick open their door, find the evidence, send them to prison.
Afraid of retaliation.
But they won't. They're actually more afraid for their family, mm-hmm. not for themselves. You rat us out, we'll kill you, everyone in your family, and you'll live. That's more painful for them.
Vicious. suspicious.
Did you know of that ever happening in your particular experience where they kill the whole family?
Several times.
How did they know who told?
Their neighbor. And sometimes, flat out lies. They didn't do anything. They weren't our informant.
It doesn't matter, though.
It doesn't. The Taliban don't care.
No.
They have no care. Because most, they're from other countries.
Why are they in Afghanistan?
Opium, money.
Opium, and we're there. Mm-hmm. We're the infidel. Mm-hmm. They get a guaranteed ticket to heaven.
So why exactly do they think we're there?
To ruin whatever they have, their lifestyle. Take away their beliefs.
It sounds like they're not there for the same reason that we're there.
The Taliban themselves? No. The people, they understand why we're there. They're just burnt out and they don't care. At first, yes, it was great. Grand. Iraq, same way. Awesome. Every day that I walked in the streets of Baghdad, I got thank you. Everyone back stateside, why are we in Baghdad? This is stupid. This is, get out of Iraq. We shouldn't be there. But every day, Iraqi national came up. Thank you.
Yeah, at the beginning they do. At the beginning they want life to be better. They picture something better.
But it goes on.
But it goes on and on and on, and it never really changes. Mm-hmm. And the Taliban originally, it kind of reminded me a little bit of like as much of you know, like the Nazis was just simply a political party that thought they were going to make things better. The Taliban kind of thought the same thing. They just became a more powerful tribe, and they thought, if we ran everything, we could make everything really much better. But the problem was that it wasn't better. Like, it was getting worse and worse and worse and worse, and they kept being like, well, no, just hang on. You know, we're good. The Taliban's great. We're going to help you.
But what they did to women.
Well, women are cattle. They don't care.
I mean,
care.
They still
their
are,
dogs
but
dogs hold their value.
Yes.
But the Taliban, it was much worse.
Right. Well, that's but I'm saying, but they fed to the elders, and the men who, because again, women have no say. So what they fed to the elders that were controlling things. You know, your clan or your group or your tribe should follow the Taliban. We're a better tribe. We're a better tribe. We're stronger. We're going to make things better. We'll protect you. We'll do things, and it got so bad that everyone, you know, was like, we're being fed lies. And that's why originally they did want American soldiers to remove them, because they were just becoming so powerful and it was not getting better. Like, that was originally in like 2003 when we were there. That was why they wanted us to do our job, help smooth things over, make things actually get a little better by building hospitals, wells, schools.
Well, let's give Connor a hand, and thank you, and Monica, too, for coming.